to ask if you can stand for a minute of silence in respect of our former colleague and very, very active member of this council and of this committee 10 years ago, Councillor Blake, very sadly. Very sadly passed away last week. Meeting of November the 19th, which are on pages 1 to 10 of the agenda. And can I ask that anybody who was here at the last meeting confirm that they're accurate about what took place at that meeting? Okay? And the next item on the agenda is a report on the Clatterbridge Sub-Acute Ward. And I think we've got. Anthony Middleton, is this? Hello, it's nice to have you here.
Thank you.
By way of a bit of background, I think this is the second report that we've had. I wasn't here for the first report, but I think there were some questions that were still people were interested to hear the answers to, and maybe I'll put them again to you tonight. So if you'd like to talk us through your report first, and then members have the opportunity to ask questions.
Thank you. So hopefully the report you see in front of you is relatively self-explanatory in terms of some of the background to the commissioning of this unit and how it functions and how we monitor the quality of the unit. At the previous meeting there was some specific questions around what questions in particular was being asked to ascertain both the staff and patient feedback. So we have included a copy of the questionnaire as an appendix to this paper. Just to reiterate, in terms of the timing of this contract, this is a two-year contract that the Trust entered into to provide this transfer to assess bed facility. It's 30 beds in total and worked along exactly the same lines as the other 95 beds that are commissioned directly by the local authority for five separate units across the Wirral, making 125 in total. There are slightly different approaches in terms of medical input into all five of those units. But the growth discharge unit probably differs in probably having the most comprehensive set of medical input in that is provided by community geriatricians, GPs and advanced nurse practitioners three times weekly. And we were very strong to emphasise the need to have that high degree of medical input throughout the week because one, we wanted to ensure that that unit could take a slightly higher level of acuity than exists within the community beds and would allow us to step down those patients that were deemed medically optimised from an acute care point of view but were just slightly over the cusp of admission levels for the other units, and that's the single different factor in terms of those beds. The contract was a 2-year contract and it ran from November 2018. Has the opportunity to be extended for a further 2 years. We'll be taking stock of that during the course of this year. But we're taking that decision in conjunction with our local authority colleagues to understand of the whole provision of T2 events across the Wirral Peninsula.
Thank you, Chair. Just under item 9 of the report, you elaborate that 40-bed rehabilitation unit is at one Clatterbridge hospital. Can you just explain a little bit more about that? You're looking at extending the service to for that unit as well.
No, sorry. It's at Clatterbridge. There are two rehabilitation wards. One's a neuro rehabilitation ward, and then there's an elderly care rehabilitation ward, which is M1. So it's not intended to extend the service to include M1, but at the moment the admissions into the Grove discharge unit purely come from the general acute bed stock, not the rehabilitation bed stock. Mm-hmm. So the view is that we will then transfer patients that are nearing the end of their rehabilitation period, those patients into the Grove discharge unit as a step down to then on to domiciliary care or residential.
Is that in conjunction with Arrow Park, people coming from Arrow Park? So
absolutely, Arrow Park, Norwich, we're all teaching hospitals covers both the Arrow Park and Clatterbridge sites. But at the moment, no admissions go via the two rehabilitation areas into the Grove discharge unit, but that is the proposal to do so.
Just a supplementary,
can I think?
So when we're looking to...
Councillor Norbury, can you switch your microphone on, please? It's only the camera doesn't work with your microphone.
Okay.
You won't get your
moment.
Yeah.
So when the...
Can you switch your
microphone on? Yeah. When the... when you're looking at... You're saying you're looking at renewing the contract. What what's the procurement process with that? Would the NHS be involved in that procurement process as one of the providers?
So the procurement that was commenced roughly 2 years ago was an open market tender process where both private sector and NHS could have bid for the provision of those services. In actual fact, the NHS didn't submit any tender. Submission along that lines, and it went to the private provider. What I referenced earlier is that there are five other commissions on the Wirral Peninsula, but commissioned directly by the local authorities as opposed to the acute hospital. And we're looking, as we go through the course of this year, whether or not a wider tendering process could be done for all 125 beds that currently exist on the Wirral Peninsula. The difference being that these are 30 beds provided within NHS hospital premises at the moment. All the other 95 are provided in using residential homes.
Okay. Councillor
Cottier. Thank you, Chair. Just looking at the table where the readmissions, where it says 15 to 21 plus days, and there's a readmission 13 to acute care. Is there any instances where people are coming back from acute care back to the unit? What basically asking them about the cause of the cycle, the cause of this trap, and do you have any figures regarding
that? I mean, yes, it's the decision taken at the acute end of the process of that patient will deem that they are medically optimised at that point. On the whole, we are dealing with quite an elderly cohort of patients here, and they've been transferred to this unit with the purpose of that step down to other cares. A number of those patients can deteriorate and then also come back into the hospital in exactly the same way that at the moment we have readmissions direct from nursing homes. We have people that are readmitted from the home that previously have been in hospitals in the previous 3 months or so, classified as a readmission. But yes, I mean, if you talk about would patients have been discharged to the road discharge and come back to the acute centre, possibly back into the road discharge and you come, that's a possibility. But in all that process, it's the clinical decision making that deems as to where their next appropriate care was provided.
Okay.
Councillor
Gilchrist.
Some queries about the data from HR. I think last time we discussed this issue, members were perhaps intrigued by the high proportion of responses to the various questions and the data that proved very favourable at the time. So I want to just explore some of the data. Perhaps on page 16, the column Daily Walkabout, where typically in the month, which is one particular query a day, but I'm wondering what sort of issues get raised on the daily walkabout. That's one question. And the second one is in relation with colleague feedback on page 17, particularly looking at August, where there's a low score for August compared to the others, and I wonder whether some background to any of these issues, what that score particularly is. It talks about patients are invited to provide feedback, so I've got customer feedback, but the column is about colleague feedback, so I'm intrigued as to what colleague feedback includes. So two questions really, what happens on the walkabout, what are the issues that are raised, and what are the issues, are there any problems with colleague feedback? Thank you, Chair.
Quite frankly, I haven't got the detail of the exact issues that have been raised within this, or not indeed the detail of exactly what the questions are around the walk around. What I can elaborate more on is the colleague feedback and the customer feedback, in that that's directly driven by the questionnaire that's attached to the back of the paper. So it will be areas where they have scored, both staff or patients have scored a level of concern in one of those, in the answer to all of those questions. happens, then that would result in an action necessary to resolve. And this is the dashboard to ensure that when those actions are taken, it's then classed as dealt with, and then we move on. So you would see, you would hope to see no outstanding actions from anything more than 30 days going. But in terms of where we sit right now in January, there are no outstanding actions from both of those areas. There's been results of the colleague satisfaction, the provider and ourselves.
Perhaps suggest, Chair, that we just get some follow-up information to fill that gap in Mr. Middleton's knowledge presently tonight.
Thank you, and I just have to dig a little bit more into it. I haven't actually understood that you're not representing Four Seasons, who are the organisation. You are, what is your role in this, if you don't mind asking?
I'm the Chief Operating Officer of Will University Teaching Hospitals.
So, are you the person who was commissioned this service? What is your role in monitoring the service, if you don't mind asking? Because I'm almost here about it.
Yes, so the acute hospital commissioned services put out a tender for the provision of these services. And Four Seasons won that contract. And as we said, that was to complement the other bits that were commissioned directly from the local authority.
Can we talk about the financial arrangements and the staffing arrangements for a minute or two? And also the standards, because I see that it's a very positive report in terms of the quality assurance that you give, that it's given, I have to say. So it's not you that's giving this, it's Four Seasons that's giving this, and you're providing it here to us. Is that have I got that right?
In one respect, in that the questionnaire and the method of quality assessment has been agreed as part of our contract and is subject to contractual review on a monthly basis between our operational team and Four Seasons. We also have a number of soft intelligence sources, if you like, in terms of social workers, doctors and our own staff that would be in contact with staff and patients on a regular basis and would alert us to any concerns.
If we could just talk about staff for a minute, the staff are directly employed by Four Seasons, is that right? The nursing staff?
The nursing staff, yes, that's
okay.
Right.
And are they paid NHS rates?
I couldn't say what rates they are on. That would be an issue between them and their employer, which is Four Seasons.
And in the event of somebody needing urgent medical assessment to return to the acute setting, who would provide that medical cover?
So because this is based on the Clatterbridge side, then they also have access to the medical cover that's provided.
That's provided by the university teaching.
Absolutely.
And it's an on-call doctor.
Absolutely. It's the RMO that's there for that site on 24 hours.
You've made comparisons between what's happening there and the other transfer to assess beds. Are we to assume from that then that the rate that you're getting from, that their Four Seasons are getting from the University Teaching Hospital is the same rate that the other transfer to assess beds are being paid at, providing the authority will let get one of those
paid? I don't think there's a precise comparator, because the model of provision across all five sites differs. So that the contract model that we have with Four Seasons is they provide the nursing support into this unit. The trust. The trust in essence is providing energy and various utility provision to that unit, so therefore we would cover that. The trust employs GPs, the trust employs its own doctors, the community trust employs the social workers. So collectively, there's a number of people. That might be a very different contractual arrangement that the local authority has with the other five providers.
Are you able to give us the rate for bed that you're paying?
The contract, which is a matter of public record, is that it's 3.5 million as a 2-year deal with Four Seasons.
And my last question, I don't know if anybody else has any more questions, I'll go back to you in a minute, is going back to quality, and given that we are making comparisons between other transfer to assess units in the borough, when was the CQC inspection carried out for us?
They had a comprehensive CQ inspection performed shortly after they opened in
Yeah, just as a result of what you were saying, Chair, I'm really interested in the procurement process leading up to this and what was asked about rates of pay, you know, and union recognition in line with NHS workers. Can you provide that?
Certainly we could provide you the detail and absolutely, you know, provide you with the documentation that was used to procure that. It was under a standard NHS contract, which was modified to pick up some of the particular issues that we wanted to pick up on some of those things. So it was an NHS contract and a local authority contract for provision of these services, but then we tailored it around issues like infection control. We wanted our team to provide the infection control input into that, the doctor and the nursing. But absolutely, you know, again, it's a matter of public documentation, so we can provide that to you.
I just wanted to ask you, in terms of governance and monitoring review of the services that are provided, who actually controls that? Is that something that is monitored via the trust, or is that something that is monitored within the broader community and the community services side of things, apart from the obviously on top of the CPC?
Yeah, so the acute trust would, the acute trust is the contract holder, if you like, or the commissioner in this particular example. We would be holding Four Seasons to account for the delivery of the quality standards that we expect, some of which are measured by some of the metrics that you see within this paper. As you say, that's in addition to the CQC approach of monitoring that is subject to any home or any provider of the services of this nature.
Okay, anybody else want to ask any questions? I think just have a, you didn't then say that it was contracted through the local authority, did you? You didn't put local authority in the mix there, did you?
No, I'm sorry, it's absolutely a contract between exactly. Four Seasons and Wirral Teaching Trust.
Okay. Anybody else want to ask any questions? Okay, well, this report is for noting, and at this moment, I don't think we need to add more comment than that. We may want to come back at a future date and see how things are progressing, and we may want to look at if there's any revision of any of the other rehabilitation services at a future date, because we're not going to look at the details of that. Thank you very much for your attendance.
Thank you
very much. Item 5 on the agenda is the Animal Social Care Complaints Report, and I think Simon Garner, who we know well, our speaker, has probably been with us as well. But we know well that it's going to present this. As I say, it is an annual report. Okay, can I leave the video for a minute?
Thank you, Chair. Can I also introduce Jenny Norwood, who is the complaints manager currently, who's here this evening. Briefly, in relation to this report, this is a statutory requirement that we produce this. The main body of the report in terms of the introduction and some of the background is covering policy and procedure, how that runs nationally and in this authority, how people make a complaint. The period that we're covering here is, as you know, April 2018 to March 2019. And a third of complaints are around commissioned services, and we've categorised these into common themes. The highlights in terms of what's different in this period compared to subsequent periods that I just want to draw out briefly from the report before we get to questions. We have seen an increase in the number of financial concerns, and they're listed at a range of different points around financial concerns that people may have. There's an increase in complexity that the team has noticed as well, and that's experienced through their investigations and inquiries. We've included in this report, as in previous years, some case studies, just because it's helpful, I think, for members to see, if we look at some of the different provision, what some of the common complaints are around those providers' services, just to get some insight into that. Since last time, we've linked the team and the outcome of complaints more closely to professional standards, and professional standards is part of the council social work service. largely a public report, so I won't go into detail about that, just for noting that that's part of what we looked at. And we have got going forward an improved database for complaints. We've had the existing one since about 2002. That's in the process now being upgraded, and that will give us some additional functionality around getting the learning out from complaints into the right places. I'm happy to take questions, Chair.
Anybody ask a question? No. Comment to make? I have a comment to make more than a question to answer. One of the things that's exercised our minds in the past has been complaints that are made to private providers that are dealt with by that provider rather than coming into the department and therefore not actually registering as a complaint. And I know that you've asked, I'm not quite sure how strict the asking is, whether it's a requirement or whether it's a request, that private providers actually report those complaints into the department so that they get taken into the hole for assessment. The last time I asked about this, I think there was not a particularly good take-up rate of that request for information. Can you fill us in on that a little bit more?
Certainly. So, request to requirement, we are saying through our contract service that homes are required to tell us about the number of complaints that they receive. Okay, and how we then monitor and enforce that requirement is ensuring that during those contract meetings we have a number of key performance indicators that we measure homes on, and we will ask them specifically in terms of the complaints that they have sent in, the numbers of complaints that they have sent in, what actions they've taken in response to those, and we will record those responses. We are also in a position then, if there are issues about that home through the CQC reporting and visits, we will follow those up through our quality assurance folk to make sure that people are following up and acting on the issues that arise from complaints. So that's the current mechanism for doing that work, for reviewing that work. We are looking at perhaps enhancing that key performance indicator to include what people say about the outcome from that complaint. So that's not in, but our complaints contracts manager is saying that they're going to introduce that so that going forward we're able to see evidence that people have said whether they're satisfied with the outcome or not, because that isn't in there at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Cottier.
Thank you, Chair. I'm just going to break down the complaints. Where do the complaints come from? Is it from the care receiver or family? Or that would be quite helpful to me in trying to grasp what this all means, to be honest. So in future, is that something that could be done?
In terms of
where the complaints actually come from, is it from the care receiver? Is it from family or family care?
Hi there, thanks for that question. The complaints that we're getting directly into the council are coming from clients themselves, residents in care homes, and also family members.
Thank you, Chair. Just to follow up on a problem where people don't report complaints. So if a care home, for example, has received a complaint but they don't tell you about it, then you obviously don't know about it, so they can't act on it. How do you manage that situation? Would there be a way of, say, informing families when they're in the system that there is a method for complaining directly to you if their complaint to the home isn't carried through?
I think it's always timely when we have our annual report to think about what else we can do, and one of the things that we will be doing after today is to write out to providers directly to restate what those expectations are. So whilst they are generally fed into the system by the contracts team, this is what you need to do, this is what we're monitoring you about, this is what we see the evidence for, I think it's timely for us as a council to write out and say it's really important that you are saying to people who are receiving a service from you and their family, this is how you can make a complaint. You can make one to the home, and this is how you do that. You can write or ring or contact the council complaints team, or you can contact the local government ombudsman. Our evidence is that it does vary, but people seem to know about those routes and do take those routes from our information. But to ensure there's consistency, I think we need to take the opportunity to give that message again.
Perhaps I worked for a long time in industry, and complaints are seen as a positive thing because that's how we know how well we're performing. So perhaps the message could be transmitted that this is a positive part of the process, that it's not negative, and perhaps more people then will actually report complaints.
I take your point. I think that's how we frame the letter, and we'll take that into account when we do that. And we do, as part of those key performance indicators, ask for compliments from home, so they are getting a balanced picture that way. But I think how we express what we're looking for should incorporate that point as well. Thank you.
Councillor Muspratt.
Thank you, Chair. Sorry, I'm sure I should know, but it's escaped me from doing, so I missed the last meeting. In 9.1, you've got more public report was issued against social care. Is there any more you could add to that, please?
Yeah, so this is the detailed further down LGO public report 9.4 will be brought to the Council Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee in June. That's the same one.
Right. Perhaps I can just add that we did receive a report to this committee on this, and it also went to the Standards Committee. It is in
the same one.
Yes, it's the same. Okay, are we all done with that? Yes? Can I say thanks very much, both of you, for coming. It's nice to see you again, Simon, and it's nice to meet you. The next item on the agenda, item 6, and we've got Lorna quickly, who is well known to us. She's Director of Policy, which is Will Health's Chair Commission. I've got that title right.
Yes,
thank you very much. It's a bit of a guess on it. You're going to present this, which is changed from the safeguard arrangements that have changed in the last 2 years. They're not going to now move on a Merseyside regional basis rather than a Will, but I think the main focus of interest tonight will be from a Wirral perspective.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you, Chair, for the introduction. Yes, you're absolutely right. I'm here tonight to present the second annual report from the Merseyside Safeguarding Adults Board, which you will have in your pack, but I have done mainly probably for me as an age memoir. I've done a quick presentation as well. Just to give you some of the background, for those who aren't aware of the changes that have been made, the board was established back in April 2017, and it does consist of four local areas, which is Moseley, Liverpool, Sefton, and ourselves, Wirral. The aim or the core duties are to be compliant with the Care Act, which is around three aspects really. It's around publishing their strategic plan, arranging adult safeguarding reviews in line with Section 44 of that Act, and also to publish an annual report, which is why I'm here tonight, that we fulfil that part of the duty. On the board, we do have some core membership and some non-core membership. And within the core membership, we have our four local authority areas. We also have CCGs, which represent the health service. We have Merseyside Police as well. And non-core membership, we have a good attendance from Merseyside Fire and Rescue. We have representatives from Health Watch. We have people in the community sector as well. And the ambulance service, and we also do have elected members from each constituent local authority. So from a world perspective, it's Councillor Chris Jones who is a member of the group. The group also, because the point of the Safeguarding Board isn't to do all of the work, but we do have a subgroup committee, which are really the engine rooms of the work that's been undertaken. And we do have five subcommittees or subgroups. They include a safeguarding adult review group, there's a communications and engagement group, a policy and practice group, a quality assurance and performance group, and a workforce development report into the safeguarding board. So I wanted to just take you through some sort of demographics that we've got. And I think you're absolutely right, Chair. It goes into all of the, across the four areas, but I think what I want to sort of hone in on really is the rural aspect of those and perhaps there may be some questions or discussion around those. So the demographics, the adult footprint that we have is 989,000 people. And our proportion rural is 255,000 adults that we have. And just some of our sort of headlines and our demand data, which I find quite interesting really. We look at, in particular, how much our safeguarding demand is and how many concerns that we have that are registered, but then how many actually go on to lead into a safeguarding inquiry. So what's called a Section 42 inquiry. This is around when a social worker has been appointed to support that person because a safeguarding allegation has been made. From our graphs, what you can see is that we have a high number of safeguarding raises, but actually we have a much smaller, which converts into what's called Section 42, a Section 42 process. And there's a number of things around that, and I suppose you can see it as a positive or you can see it as a negative. From a positive perspective, we do have a lot of concerns raised, and you could say, well, that's really good, because actually what's happening is people are aware of safeguarding issues and wanting to raise them and know how to raise. But what it ends up having is that we end up with a lot of things coming through a front door, which is a large amount, which actually, when it's whittled down, isn't as large as what we need, what was there. So it's looking at actually some of those safeguardings, are they truly safeguarding referrals, or are there concerns about care that actually could be dealt with differently, so that actually we can look at our safeguardings and put them through that Section 42, but also as well the care concerns, we still need to take them seriously, but they may not lead to a full safeguarding review, and that can impact on workload. It could be that we've got education and training issues as well, that we need to ensure that people understand what is a true safeguarding referral and what is a care concern as well. And I know I've probably still got Simon behind me, but Simon is leading a piece of work around what's called our front door, which is our multi-agent safeguarding hub, to try and disaggregate some of this, to get us working as efficiently as we can, that the most serious people and serious allegations, we're able to treat them promptly. That's the other thing, if you're getting a lot of people coming through, we may not be treating them as timely as we can, and making sure that we have the right processes in place. So I think on that one, I think the take-home message is, yes, we do stick out on that. We're aware of it, we are really working on it, and Simon's doing a lot of work leading from a multi-agency perspective to ensure that we get the right people to the signposted to the right place. Then leading on to the types of abuse that we have, and what we've seen is, what I've put out there is that we've got an increase in physical abuse, but we actually have a decrease in domestic violence from a rural perspective. And I think some of this, and we've had quite a lot of conversations around it as a board, is around the complexities around what is physical abuse, what is domestic violence, and the recording of some. We liaise very closely with the police, and I know it's something that from an overview and scrutiny committee you're concerned around our rates of domestic violence, and I think absolutely we need to do some more work locally and use it as a priority to work with our community safety partnership. What the police from Merseyside are saying is that there were 6,300 crimes associated with the domestic abuse. And they're saying cases haven't gone up, but the crime has changed due to national reporting systems. So for example, what they're saying is that if there is damage to property, that is recorded differently than domestic violence. And I think we really need to unpick this and understand what it means for our population, because I think from your perspective, you've got the feel that there's an increase there, and we need to understand it and say this could be, well, we accept what the board is saying from the statistics,
This is a local issue for us that we want to tackle locally and make it one of our priorities for the forthcoming year. Another type of abuse that we have seen in Wirral on the increase is financial abuse. Again, it's another complex issue, but across all of the areas, it is seeing an increase across Merseyside. That is being reflected nationally as well. Indicators of financial abuse include changing living conditions, it can be a lack of heating, clothing or food, inability to pay bills, unexplained withdrawals from accounts, addition of authorised signatures or unauthorised signatures on donor cards and signature cards, and sudden changes in wills. So they're the sort of signs that we're looking for when we're looking for financial abuse. The other type of abuse that we have been looking at is around psychological and also neglects and acts of aggression as well. And again, I think this is an area where locally we're looking at having some more scrutiny around this. Psychological abuse is also known as emotional abuse, and it's a relatively new concept in terms of safeguarding. And sometimes, again, are we recording psychological abuse? And it could be actually domestic abuse. So again, it's just trying to map those together to actually get a full understanding of what this is showing for us. Year before last, the Adult Safeguarding Board did commission Liverpool University to look at workshops in relation to neglect, and we've certainly looked at self-neglect being a big issue as well. And what we've managed to do this year is publish tools to try and support practitioners in identifying and looking, seeing signs and symptoms of neglect and self-neglect. And we have had some serious for safeguarding adult abuse. We have seen some cases of neglect that has led to deaths through fires and hoarding and things, which are all seen as from a safeguarding perspective. The other types of abuse that we have as well, which are showing up for us, is sexual abuse and sexual exploitation. We're seeing again across Merseyside, and a small percentage increase for ourselves over the last year as well. This could be that we are seeing these referrals coming in from healthcare professionals and frontline practitioners, so we could actually be seeing an increase in awareness in people who are looking after people in sexual abuse. In the majority of cases with regards to sexual abuse, the alleged perpetrators were known to the individual,